So hello, I'm Kevin Lewis, and welcome back to our masterclass on data governance with AWS. So now we're going to talk about the data governance capabilities, the data management aspects of data governance. So we'll go through those. Now that we have talked about how to get the program started, we can get into a little bit more detail about the things that the data governance program does to prepare data to be successful with business initiatives, okay? So, you know, let's start with a challenge that we see. A lot of times you'll see data governance equated with one or two very specific data management capabilities. So for example, a data catalog, which is a very important element of a data governance program, but it doesn't equal data governance, okay? It's one important part of the program, or you'll see a data governance program equated with access rights and who can access what data and associated with security and privacy and compliance and those kinds of things. And again, those are very, very important aspects of a data governance program. But in order to be successful in ensuring the data is ready for supported business initiatives, we need to think holistically about what it means to manage the data effectively, what it means to make sure the data is in the right condition to support the business initiatives. So we can organize this under sort of three broad buckets: understanding the data, protecting the data, curating the data. Okay, so, and within each of these, we can talk about specific data management practices. So let's go through those. So when it comes to understanding the data, let's start with data profiling. The idea of data profiling is simply examining data in a systematic way to through statistics and other elements to see, is there anything wrong with this data? So it's systematically looking at the data to look for challenges that may hinder the success of business initiatives. So here we can think about, and through all of these data management practices, we can think about the partnership again between IT and the business. Because if I am profiling data and I'm using statistics to understand the data and looking for issues with the data, you know, it's important to know we're never going to get the data perfect. You know, every single customer attribute is never going to be 100% correct for every customer. So that's why it requires the business. That's one reason why I acquire someone like a data steward from the business to help me think through not only is this data right or wrong, but even more importantly, how is this issue going to impact the targeted business initiative? So it takes this world of potential problems and brings it down into a much, much more narrow and manageable scope. And again, this is why it's so important to have targeted business initiatives that you're cascading from to make a decision. It's not just to justify the program, it's to get down into the details as to what actual work needs to be done to ensure the data is ready. So data profiling is the first one. Then we can talk about data catalog. Again, one part of a healthy data governance program is making sure that the data is available for people who need access to it. So a good data catalog should allow the end user and application developers to not have to hunt everywhere for the data that they're looking for their projects, but it's available very easily and it's well documented and it's accessible. And then there's data lineage. So when I'm looking at data, I wanna know where did it come from? Which data sources did it come from? How is that data translated on its way to the data that I'm actually looking at? So all of these are around understanding the data. Then it comes to curating the data. So we talked about profiling the data, looking for data quality issues. Now, what do we do about those data quality issues? So if there is a challenge with customer data attributes, if there is a challenge with, you know, claims data, whatever it is, now I need to first I've prioritized and I've decided which issues I want to address, because there may be issues with the data that's just out of scope and you have to leave it the way it is for now. But then you focus on the specific issues that are going to get in the way of your targeted initiatives. This is where data quality management comes into play. And again, this is why we need a partnership between IT and the business, because there's tools that can help support this, but you need business knowledge of the data itself and its role in the targeted initiative. So for data quality management, we're going to do things like get to the root of what's causing it. Maybe there is a technical issue bringing data in from a source. Maybe there's some mistakes in the translation as data comes from a certain source. Maybe there are issues in the business process. So when we talk about, you know, we talked about claims adjudication earlier. Well, when someone is reporting a claim, are there free-form text fields that are not descriptive enough to be able to provide the information necessary for the targeted initiatives? That is going to require potentially training, and it may require even monitoring of the issue going forward. So when we've narrowed down our data quality work to very specific issues, then I want to set up some data quality rules so that in production, I'm looking for these issues to emerge. If I can't just fix them through a technical change to feel 100% confident that those data elements are going to be correct, then I want to alert and provide some reporting around the issues so that we can take action very proactively in a closed loop. So that's data quality management, data integration. So we may need to collect data from a variety of sources. Well, that data needs to fit together coherently. So you need processes and tools to do that. So going back to claims, for example, let's say I have, I've had a merger and I have two business units under two brands within one insurance company, but yet I need to do analysis on claims data across the company, and I need to link that claims data to policy data and so on. Well, I have to take data from system A claims data and data from system B claims data, and they're not automatically going to match up. But if I need to do analysis on that, then I need people to work together to make sure that happens. It is not just a technical process, but it's actually going field by field in terms of what I'm analyzing so that it links together in a coherent way. So that's data integration. Master data management is, it's like data integration, but it's taking on you know, special responsibilities for certain entities like customers, suppliers, products. These are entities that have special considerations because these the master data tends to show up in a variety of systems about the same entity. So information about the same customer will show up in multiple systems. Information about the same product will show up in multiple systems. And they'll be organized typically into hierarchies and categories and that kind of thing. So master data management takes on those special characteristics that you're going to need to make sure that the master data is in a condition necessary to be integrated from a variety of sources, and then so that it's managed effectively and coherently. And then, okay, so now we're in protect. So so that's another you know, classification of data management practices, protecting the data. And to protect the data, we want to do things like, you know, basic security. So who can have access to the data? When should they have access to the data? What roles should have access to the data just as a natural course of their job? So you have, again, a lot of information about individual customers. Which roles as a natural part of their responsibilities in customer service or sales or whatever it is, which data should they have automatic and easy access to because of the role that they're in? But then you have other, you know, sort of project-based responsibilities, or there's one particular activity where there's a request to access certain data. Again, this is where the data steward participates, but also the data owner, because we need to establish policies, not only general policies around who has access to what data automatically as a part of their job, but to make specific decisions on a project by project basis that maybe someone needs temporary access to sensitive data. And that's where, you know, the data owner is gonna be very helpful. And then compliance, of course, there's all kinds of regulations around data, and this is getting more and more important over time. So we need to make sure we're not only complying to company policy, but also we're being conscious of, you know, regulations that are looking to protect the privacy of individuals. So we have to be very aware of the regulations that are in place today and the regulations that are proposed and going to be important going forward. And then finally, in the protect category, we have the data management practice of data lifecycle management. So this is simply about being conscious about storing data and over time, how you want to store that data in the most cost-effective way. So for example, you may need to keep information about employees over years and years. But if the data is very old, you may not need instant access to that data. So data lifecycle management helps us think through not only how long do I need to keep data, but it also what mechanism should I use to store that data so that it's available when I need it, but we're also cost optimizing that so that we can keep as much data as we need, but we're not overspending on that capability simply because we want to keep that data around for a long time just in case we need it for a specific purpose. So that's data lifecycle management. And then with data lifecycle management, you want to think about the business initiatives that you're supporting and what needs to, what kind of archival requirements are there for the data that you're working with in that initiative. And really, I want to reemphasize all of these data management practices. You know, the question comes up, where should I start? And it's very, very common when we run through all of these data management capabilities. Geez, you've talked about data quality management and data integration and security and all of these things. Let's start with master data management. Let's start with data quality management. I have to reemphasize that it's not a matter of which one do you start with. It's a matter of what is your target? What is the targeted business initiative? What is the condition of that data? So you may find, for example, in a customer experience initiative that customer data is fragmented to the extent that the customer experience across multiple channels is going to be hindered because you have separate data stores and unreconciled data of that customer across your various channels. So it's not that you're going to do master data management because it's a good idea. You're going to do it because it's absolutely essential. You're not going to do all of master data management. You're going to do master data management for a segment of customer data that is necessary to succeed. And you're going to do it in such a way that it can scale so that you can extend one initiative after the other, more customer data for master data management. And then maybe take those same capabilities and extend it into product and vendor, but not because we want to create a foundation for any possible use case, but because we are prioritizing based on the targeted use cases and we're building it out. Remember, we talked about that every act of data governance should do basically two things. Number one, help you succeed with a very targeted business initiative and an application or analytic use case within that initiative. And two, it should help you extend your capability overall. It should help you get better and better over time with data management across the board and help you integrate data better across a variety of initiatives, help you reuse data better. So that's important with this. So let me talk about what happens when we are thinking too narrowly. We're not thinking holistically. So I was working with a financial services organization and it was one of those situations where they had a data governance program, but it was very heavily equated with data cataloging. And they did have a very nice data catalog, but the problem was that when application teams or end users went to the data catalog to find the data that they would need, they could find data, but it was not described very well. It was very, very difficult to thread data together across domains so that to join data, again, from different business units. So you have, let's say, mortgage and credit card data, and that data needs to be joined together in some kind of holistic way. Well, without things like master data management and data integration, simply a data catalog is not enough to be able to thread that data together for the end. So then the end user and the application development teams were burdened with having to thread it together for their projects. And the worst part of it is that they would have to do it over and over and over again for the different projects that required threading very core data together. And then there was issues of trust of the data that they found. And so quality wasn't as proactively dealt with. So the point I'm trying to make here is that we need to think holistically, But that does not mean that we implement all of them all at once, or even any one of them completely. We take pieces of each of these data management practices and we prioritize them, and we'll talk about how to do this in a roadmap. We prioritize them to support the very targeted use cases, and little by little, everything begins to fill in over time. And this happens in real life. You see a significant acceleration of projects, because the best data management that you can do, the most effective data management you can do, is the data management you don't have to do at all, because it's been done before. And again, we see this when we have a well-coordinated data governance program targeting specific initiatives. You build momentum over time, you build capability and quality over time, and then the work that you do simply extends and enhances your data resource rather than starting over again. So we'll talk more about sort of how to plan that out, and we'll get into more details about the responsibilities and how to distribute those to implement these data management practices. And so we'll see you in the next video.